Hello, malty. Metatheosophic malt mates. Yes, I'm Ralphie, and thank you to Barry Morgan for that malt mention. Introducing Whisky Review 564, I think. I'm reasonably confident, but I'm not 100% certain because I didn't actually write it down before I started recording. But never mind, we're not going to bother about that. You're here for a whisky review. And here's the whisky, here's the glass, here's the water to add to it. Let's get splashing. A splash and a dash of Bruichladdich 16-year-old bourbon matured single malt. Bottled at 46%. Squeaky cork time. Bottled at 46%. Unchill filtered. Natural colour. And lots of other good stuff. Now, before I go any further, watch with whiskey corks. You will find when you open a bottle of single malt whiskey, the majority have corks. These are not wine bottle corks, which are hard corks, compressed corks. These are soft corks designed for going in and out of bottles all the time. They are a temporary seal, not a permanent seal. When you press the cork between your fingers, you will find that it's quite soft and spongy. And over time, due to Mother Nature's interference, that sponginess will start to deteriorate. There is an idea that if you are keeping your whiskies in a collection, if you wet the cork, so to speak, that it'll stop this happening. Well, no, it won't. Not in my experience. Really, ideally, you want to keep things as sealed as possible and control your storage environment as carefully as possible. Keep things cool, keep things dark, and importantly, undisturbed. Corks can spoil over time. I've seen it. They shrink, they shrivel, they completely lose their integrity of their seal. And really, it's the outside cover, the outside seal, which in fact can be preserving the neck fill level of the liquor inside your bottle over the longer term. Just be aware of that, malt mates. I'm Ralphie, and I'm just sharing with you. That's all that's happening here. Anyway, time to share a nose, a taste, and a malt mark. It's been quite a while since I've reviewed a Bruichladdich single malt. There's a reason for that, which I will come to shortly after I've done this specific review. But the last whiskey from this distillery I reviewed was Whiskey Review 464, which was Port Charlotte, a more smoky, peatier version of Bruichladdich. Successfully so, I might add, which was from an independent bottler. But my last Bruichladdich was, in fact, 3 years ago. And that's essentially when I last bought a bottle of Bruichladdich. It was 3 years ago. In 2011, when the 10-year-old became my whiskey of the year. And then I reviewed it for you in January 2012. But do you know what? I haven't actually touched a drop since, really, until I bought this bottle. I'll come back to that, the reasons for that, shortly. Nose. Lovely, fresh, clean, juicy, fresh fruit, dried fruit combination, what you would call a fruit compo. It's fresh fruit and dried fruit in a little light sugar syrup and used for desserts occasionally or for baking. But in this case, it's making a very fine introduction to an Islay single malt. Also reassuring, I'm getting that honey note that you get from bourbon, that honey vanilla combination, but it's combined with that brininess that's coming through from the spirit, very much intact and delightful to experience again after all these years. The brininess is part of the feature of a traditional Bruichladdich. It's not just sea salt. It's not the same saltiness that you'll find in Old Pulteney. It's more shoreline saltiness. It's not particularly heavily peated. No way. It's not that peated mineral marine note that you might occasionally come across in Bowmore. This is much more, you know, a combination of various things you'll come across in a shoreline is the salt air, the brine, the dampness in the air, the seaweed, and the minerality that you can get from the seashells, for example. All that put together is really what defines the Bruichladdich marine character. Taste-wise, oh, a big, sharp, full-on fruit burst arrival. It's not harsh. It's not sour. It's not unpleasant by any means. In fact, it's wonderfully pleasant. It's just a very rich, condensed arrival of a malt. And you will find this, by the way, some whiskies. I'm going to add some water now. 1-2 spoons should do. 2 full teaspoons of water to this. This needs to kind of tame down a little bit, settle down a little bit. Use some of that gregarious intensity of its first arrival, first contact, and the taste buds. So let that settle down in the glass, and I'll just say that you will occasionally find something I don't really talk about too often, but probably mention a little bit more, is the concentration of a malt for its strength in relation to its strength. So why is it you can get some single malt Scotch whiskies which at 40% volume taste more like they're a 46% volume whiskey, and how come you can get a 48% malt which you think's bottled at higher strength, and yet the actual experience, particularly in the palate, is more like a 40% volume whiskey? And it's really to do with the actual tangible concentration of flavours within the set volume of alcohol. It does vary between whiskies, and it can vary quite significantly. You'll know it, malt mates, when you experience it, and you cannot beat experience. Experience is everything, and on your own terms. Watch you don't get confused by any prejudice or preconceptions that you actually take on board, thinking that you're doing the right thing to the general communal group around you and to the whisky world. Forget it. Always approach whisky entirely in your own terms, because basically the smell and taste can only be your experience and nobody else's by its very definition. That's why when I'm sharing with you, I'm saying this is what I'm experiencing. I'm not telling you what you should experience. Absolutely no way. That would be ridiculous. This is ridiculously fruity and lovely. There's a wonderful fresh oak coming through, infused with honey. It's delightful. That minerality. So you get I'll start again. I'm getting slightly overexcited with this because it's such a character. What you have, the arrival, is fresh and dried fruit. I'm picking out some apricot and some banana and some guava. That's what I'm noticing. Also, figs, yeah, no problem. It'll be in there, but much more subtle. That's the arrival. The fruit then moves into the development, and as it passes into the development, in the early stages, you'll come across this presence of sweet, fresh American oak, that honey and vanilla and slightly brown sugar or confectioner's sugar thing going on. Again, beautifully balanced and standing out quite neatly defined against the fruit elements of the spirit itself. And then into the finish, you're getting that marine quality that Bruichladdich is so noted for. That complex marine quality. It's a little bit salt, it's a little bit seaweed, it's a little bit shoreline as the tide's going out. That's what it is. And it's just wonderful. And it goes from the latter part of the development through into the finish, where it meets a little cup of over-brewed English breakfast tea, and it just sits there quite comfortably until it fades. What a lovely, enjoyable, decent, characterful single malt. I also note that the character continues to develop and the flavour profile as well continues to develop the longer this whisky sits in the glass. So it's a slow opener. You need to give it time. A minute for every year in the cask. 16 years in the cask, 16 minutes in the glass would not be unreasonable. It'll go on for longer. Malt mark. Let's have a malt mark. Here's the malt. And here's the mark. If my little butter fingers can actually pick it up and place it in the deck, on the barrel area, 89 out of 100. Do you know what malt makes? That is not bad at all. That is not bad at all. Do you know, if you ever come across a bad whiskey, which, or a reasonable whiskey, which kind of lets itself down a little bit, one of the best things to do to recover from that is look out a good whiskey. Remind yourself of what a good whiskey tastes like. And bear in mind, a bad whiskey experience is not a waste of time, because it is in understanding what makes a whiskey bad or less quality helps you to define and understand the tangible parameters of what a good quality whiskey actually is. There you go. Now you know. Bruichladdich, famous for its 1001 varieties. In 2001, the distillery was bought by essentially a wine merchant who had a small independent bottling company, who was actually after Ardbeg but didn't get Ardbeg. So he went for Bruichladdich instead, and they got a pretty sound team, you know, really good experienced people to get that distillery up and running. And at that moment in time in 2001, I was really enjoying the story, the legend that they were creating for themselves. It was understood that they'd inherited some pretty poor quality stock from Jim Beam Brands, who had not been looking after the quality of their casks. And perhaps that says something about Jim Beam casks. I'm not going to make too much of a comment there. I'm just giving you an opinion and perspective, malt mates. That's all it is. And they had to do their acing and double this, you know, the double maturation. They had to bring in wine casks from here and there. Bruichladdich had their own cooper, John, an absolute gentleman. And I tell you what, really, really knew his stuff. Any distillery that is investing in a long-term future needs a cooper. Right. Needs a cooper on site. Even if it's just to check the leaks that are springing up in some of the casks in storage, because they're actually easy to plug these leaks if you know how. It's all down to the knowledge. Well, most of them anyway, most of the leaks. If a cask has been really badly made up, really badly assembled, not tested, water and pressure tested before it's sent out, well, your entire cask can be gone within a month. You know, so distillers, really be aware of your casks, and it does no harm to actually put some water into a cask you've had delivered and put in, you know, the pressure hose and really blast it and check for any damp patches appearing. Just sharing. But Bruichladdich, I was the first Scotsman actually in the Bruichladdich Academy. It ran for a week. It was quite expensive to go, but my goodness, Jim McEwen gave us some very, very nice drams to, you know, purely for research and, you know, to improve the calibre of our palates, you understand. I mean, we weren't tasting all this wonderful whiskey for fun. Oh, heaven forbid, you know, this is education. Serious stuff. The meals that were cooked for us were excellent. The accommodation was fine. I had a great time there. And that was that point where, before I bought a few barrels from the distillery, I actually went to John the cooper and I said, John, you're the cooper here. Can you show me which barrels to pick? And I carefully, secretly marked the barrels so I would know if they'd been swapped over. It's the things we do. But it was I bought two casks then. You know, this is in 2001, at a time when people weren't really getting into buying casks of whiskey. And even at that point, things were looking kind of optimistic for Scotch whiskey, but it certainly, it wasn't the massive meal ticket that the industry likes to make out it is nowadays here in 2015, going through to 2016. I digress. It was fascinating to operate the stills, to be rolling and stacking casks in a warehouse. You may think, malt mates, we've got over time that we understand whiskey, but it's when you're actually doing the job at a distillery that you get that whole extra dimension of understanding whiskey. One reason why I always have my single malts with a drop of water, and I never mix my single malts into a cocktail, I just never ever do it, because I can remember spending a day with the team at Bruichladdich taking filled casks up from the distillery, up the back road, and stacking them, handballing them into the warehouse. And I can assure you, malt mates, you really have to watch your fingers, because a full cask of liquor, and once it's gathered a bit of momentum and it's rolling down the concrete path into a dunnage warehouse, if you get your fingers caught in the end of it between one cask and another, it's going to take your fingers off. Or if you're lucky, it'll just turn them to mush. Got to be really careful. And my goodness, once one of these big sherry butts starts rolling, don't even try and stop it. Just get out its way. Let it go where it will. The best thing you can hope is that you can get a piece of wood in to just kind of start to slow it down or even adjust its direction. Steering a cask is such an art form, and I'm ever so grateful to Duncan McGilvery for showing me the craft of cask rolling. There's a lot to that, malt mates. You've got to look at the cask, look at the camber and the angle of the curve, and understand the true shape of the cask before you send it rolling down a pathway. And then, of course, lifting up in a forklift onto the three high stack, you've got to get your cask just at the right position so that when it reaches its static point, its final resting place for maturation of the contents, that the bung's facing up the way. It's facing towards the stars, towards the angels, malt mates. Because if it isn't, there's a chance the bung could leak and the contents spill out. It happens. When Bruichladdich was sold off in 2012, for all its faults, it's 1,001 variable varieties. I was deeply disappointed because there are too few small singular distilleries in Scotland. There's just too few. There's just not enough. So when the bank, I'll reword that because I don't know the facts. I've never asked the facts. When the owners of Bruichladdich decided to sell out, and importantly, the backers of the distillery, the banks, including banks, wanted a return on their investment in a fairly short space of time, in my opinion, then reluctantly the owners had to sell. Some have now gone into a comfortable retirement. Some have now gone on to other projects in Ireland. I wish them all well. Colourful characters, one and all, who provided us with a period of genuine drama, reality television stroke meets real life distillery drama with the goings on at this distillery and their singularity. It's something that big companies cannot do. And my advice to any small distillery starting up now is try and avoid getting backed by banks, financial institutions, and the rest. What you need are angel investors who are prepared to make a longer journey with you and who are prepared to invest in the quality of what you're producing and not just the brand name. You need people who will willingly come to private contracts to invest you in the long term. And how about a little bit of crowdsourcing? How about approaching, if you're in Scotland, approach the Scottish government and see if they give you a little bit of a helping hand in the form of a grant, a startup business grant. They're out there. But if your investors control the distillery, you don't. If you own it, if you manage it, if you claim it's yours, but if you don't have financial control, it's not yours. You're just a hired hand. So keep your distillery small, plan it small, plan its long-term future small, but keep control of it. Keep your hands on the tiller, on the steering wheel, because if you don't, someone else will, then they will own it, and that character, that personality can fade away. I'm not saying it has with Bruichladdich, but when Bruichladdich sold out to Remy Cointreau, for me, that was just a sad day. And no criticism to Remy Cointreau. Good luck to them. Paid a lot of money for the distillery. But I just don't believe big companies can bring a certain life, a certain spark to a distillery like a handful of keen, enthusiastic, if sometimes flawed, but characters can bring to a distillery. So if you're a small distillery, stay small, accept it, work with it, make it your strength. And remember, wherever you are, Ralphie is watching. See you soon, malt mates. When you come back, I'm going to be reviewing another Islay single malt. Ooh, what will it be? It's going to be a big surprise. That's what it's going to be. Cheers for now.